what our body is made up of. So Jad Bharat, he's analyzing who are we and how we are different from our body. Now this is very important. This is called Sankhya Yoga. It seems Jad Bharat, he is quite adept in Sankhya philosophy. Maybe from his previous births, like Bharat Maharaj, etc. But he has this knowledge, and he clearly understands his soul different from this body, different from mind, different from intelligence, false ego, I'm spirit soul. Now this is what we have to understand. I'm soul and not this body. Srila Prabhupada always he emphasized on this point in his books, that I'm not this body. But the question is how we are not this body. That we have to understand. Just like Prabhupada used to say, God is great. But then the question comes, how God is great? So Rahugan, so Jad Bharat, he is telling how we are different from this body. And this is the function of Sankhya philosophy. All philosophies, I mean to say all theistic philosophies, they accept that we are soul, we are not this body. So even if they don't accept the conception of God, this everybody is going to accept that we are soul, we are not this body. But how we are different from this body, that is explained by Sankhya. So Sankhya philosophy says, so Jad Bharat is making a point, ekadasham manasohi vrittaya, that we have 11 senses, and then there is the 11th one is, of course, here they say the here Jad Bharat is taking a different take altogether. He's saying we have 11 senses, which includes false ego. So 5 working senses and 5 knowledge acquiring senses, plus false ego. This is 11. And these 11 are all, the center point is mind. The central point is mind. So all these 11 senses, including which are also including false ego, the information, they collect all this information. 5 functioning senses, they collect information. 5 knowledge acquiring senses, they collect information. False ego develops some conceptions in itself. And all this information is passed to mind. So mind can be understood as a central processing unit, CPU. You can think like that. So then Jad Bharat continues. Akute apancha dhiya abhimana matrani karmani puram chatasam. So puram, so matrani karmani. So what they do is, so knowledge acquiring senses, they have matrani. So matrani means sense perceptions and sense objects. Srila Prabhupada translates as sense objects, but it also includes sense perceptions. And then karmani. Knowledge acquiring senses, for knowledge acquiring senses, the word uses matrani, which is technically called as tanmatra. Knowledge acquiring senses, they perceive sense objects, and that is called matrani. And working senses, they do some actions. So for that, the word uses karmani. So matrani, karmani, puram chatasam. And with these senses, and mind and false ego, we are staying in Puram. Puram means a city. We are staying in this body. We are soul. We are surrounded by this 11 senses and mind, and we are staying in this body, which is called Puram. In this body, in this society, in this country, in a house, we are working here in this city. So city, it depends how do you translate Puram as. So he says, Vadanti hi ekadasha veerabhumi. So he says, so Jad Bharat is making a point that ultimately we are not all of this. We are not this city, we are not this mind, we are not these 11 items. We are separate from all of them. We are Satchit Ananda, Chinmay, spirit souls. That's what जड़ भारत इज ट्राइंग टू मेक अस अंडरस्टैंड. दैट्स व्हाट प्रभुपाद सेड, सर्वोपाधि विनिर्मुक्तम तत्परत्वेन निर्मलम ऋषिकेशेन ऋषिकेश सेवनम भक्ति रुच्यते. फेमस वर्स. दिस वर्स इज कोटेड बाय रूपा गोस्वामी नेक्टर डिवोशन बट इट ही कोट्स इट फ्रॉम आई थिंक ही कोट्स इट फ्रॉम नारद पंचतंत्र नारद पंत्रात्र. सो दिस इज अ फेमस वर्स विच कम्स इन इनिशियल पार्ट ऑफ नेक्टर ऑफ डिवोशन. प्रभुपाद सेज सर्वोपाधि इफ यू वॉन्ट टू डू भक्ति यू हैव टू बी फ्री फ्रॉम ऑल उपाधिज. दिस प्रभुपाद पुट इट सिंपली यू आर नॉट इंडियन यू आर नॉट अमेरिकन एंड प्रभुपाद सेज यू नॉट दिस बॉडी यू नॉट दिस माइंड यू नॉट दिस सेंसेस यू नॉट दिस फॉल्स ईगो यू आर स्पिरिट सोल्स. नाउ दिस सीम्स दिस इज कॉल्ड सांख्य फिलोसफी बट दिस अपियर्स इन हेयरिंग इट अपियर्स वेरी इजी बट इन प्रैक्टिस इट्स वेरी डिफिकल्ट टू एक्चुअली अंडरस्टैंड दैट वी आर नॉट ऑल ऑफ दिस. दिस इज वेरी डिफिकल्ट बिकॉज दिस बॉडी एंड दिस माइंड पुल्स अस डाउन. दिस सोसाइटी आवर होम्स दे पुल अ कॉन्शियसनेस डाउन बैक अगेन into gross into this gross gross field of consciousness. So like for example if you have this body now we might understand we are not this body but suppose if you get a disease then you will become fearful. Now many devotees they mail me and they said Prabhuji I have this disease I have become so fearful. The question is why do you become fearful if you're not this body? If something happens to your shirt, you don't become fearful. You're concerned about the shirt, but that my shirt is torn, but there's no fear. But the fact is, if something happens to your body, which is almost like shirt, which Krishna says, Basham si jirnani atha vihaya, then we become fearful. So there's a difference between something happening to your shirt and something happening to your body. Although both of them, we understand, we are neither shirt nor a body. So then, why there's a difference of feelings? Because we are not self-realized. We are not realized. We have a information we are not this body by these kind of verses, but we have not got realization we are not this body. That's why we get fear. And that is why Krishna says in Bhagavad Gita, Ma Suchah, Krishna says, do not fear. Fear is a symptom of attachment. That's why Krishna says, Vit Raga Bhaya Krodha. After Raga comes Bhaya. So fear is a symptom of attachment. That's very important to understand. Where there is attachment, there is fear. There is fear of losing the objects to whom you are attached to. There is fear of happening something to the objects you are attached to. So there is a fear. But if you are not attached to any objects, then there will be no fear. That's all. Simple. If you have a car and so people often buy brand new cars. And then they are fearful, some scratch might happen, something might happen to my car, because they are attached to the car. But if they are not attached, then they will have no fear. That's the whole point there. So by fear we can understand how much we have realized we are not this body, we are not this mind. Now sometimes the mind starts thinking something and then we are disturbed. So fear, vetraga, bhaya, krodha, another symptom of attachment to this body and mind is frustration and anger. So these two, fear and frustration and anger, frustration or anger you can take, krodha, fear and anger, they are signs and symptoms of being attached to anything, attached either to body, attached to family, attached to nation, attached to our own mind, our own concepts. If you're not attached to anything, if you're devoid of attachment, sarvapadi viniruktam, that the test is that you will have no fear and no anger. That's simple. So if there is no fear, no anger, that means you are undisturbed. And that's what Krishna raises a theme in Bhagavad Gita. My devotee is undisturbed amidst cold and heat, isn't it? And what's that? Sukh, dukh. So, Shitoshna, summer, winter, he's equanimous, he's not disturbed. So that's very important to understand. Jad Bharat is known as Jad Bharat. Why? Because Jada means he's inert. He's not spiritually inert, but he's inert to external conditions. He's inert to anything happening to his body, to society, to nation, to his mind. He doesn't care about that. He actually cares about these things, but at the same time he's not disturbed. These are two different things. He's not a careless fellow. But he understands that I should not be disturbed, because this is something external to me. External things. These are something external. So that's a big test. So if you want to test, and Srila Prabhupada says the degree of advancement in devotion can be checked by how much you are attached, by how much you are not attached to this body, mind and false ego. That's the test of advancement in devotional life. The more you are detached from your body, from mind, from senses, the more you are advanced. Simple. And that's why Bhagavatam says, what's that verse? Janyati ashu vairagyam jnanam chatat ahitukam. So Vasudeva Bhagavati Bhakti Yoga Prayojita Janyati ashu vairagyam jnanam chatat ahitukam. Srimad Bhagavatam says, the test of devotion is vairagya, renunciation. Renunciation. That's very important. Kuch awaaz aa rahi? Ya Hare Krishna. Yeah, what's happening? The volume is good for me. Ye kya ho raha hai? Ye awaaz nahi aa rahi kya? Acha, voice is very low. इसको चेंज करो, दूसरे को दूसरा करो. एक जस्ट अ मिनट. ये क्या हो गया? हरे कृष्णा. नाउ नाउ वॉइस इज ओके.
यस यस.
एंड नाउ वॉइस इज ओके. एक्चुअली समथिंग वाज ऑफ हियर. समथिंग वाज ओके. इट्स अ ओके. सो फाइन. सो आई विल जस्ट स्पीक. ओके. सो so should I repeat or what happened? You missed everything.
Prabhuji, continue.
Recording in
okay.
progress.
Okay. So the whole point was that ultimately Srila Prabhupada said that the degree of advancement in devotional life is checked by the amount of renunciation you have. Now this is a very important point, because generally we think that advancement can be checked by ecstasy in devotion, by attachment to Krishna, but that is okay. But Bhagavatam doesn't say like that. Bhagavatam doesn't say that advancement in devotion can be checked by your attachment to Krishna or the ecstasy you feel, because his words of Bhagavatam, Vasudeva Bhagavati Bhakti Yoga Prayojita Janyati ashu vairagyam jnanam chatat ahitukam. This verse, I think this verse is, what is this verse, Srimad Bhagavatam, which verse is this? Yeah, I think first canto, second chapter, eighth verse, I think, you can check it. So this verse is very clear. Vasudeva Bhagavati. So who is God? Vasudev. Now Bhakti Yoga Prayojita. So anybody who is, prayojan means goal, anybody whose goal is bhakti, devotion towards Vasudev. Vasudev means Krishna, who is God, Bhagavati. Then what's the symptom of it? So if he's advancing in bhakti, then what's the symptom? Bhagavatam clearly says जनयति आशु वैराग्यम ज्ञानम च तत् अहितुकम्। ज्ञान एंड वैराग्य भागवतम क्लियरली सेड्स, भागवतम डजंट से एक्सटेसी। ओके सो दिस वर्स इज 127 फर्स्ट कैंटो सेकंड चैप्टर सेवेंथ वर्स, यू कैन करेक्ट इट, इट्स नॉट एट्थ वर्स सेवेंथ वर्स। सो भागवतम इज वेरी क्लियर, भागवतम सेज वेल द सिम्टम ऑफ एडवांसमेंट ऑफ डिवोशन इज नॉट एक्सटेसी, देयर इज नो वर्ड भावा हियर, दे डोंट से द सिम्टम ऑफ अटैचमेंट इज अटैचमेंट टू कृष्णा, देयर इज नो रति और राग हियर। सुखदेव गोस्वामी यूजेस टू वर्ड्स, वैराग्य एंड ज्ञान। So and that's why Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, there's a famous verse by Srinivas Acharya, he composed a verse, Vairagya Bhakti, so there's a verse, Vairagya Vidya Nija Bhakti Yoga Shikshartham Ekam Purusha Purana. This is a famous verse where it is said, Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, he brought devotion which is ornamented by Vairagya and Vidya. Now that's very important. Important insight into it, and this verse is composed by Srinivas Acharya, who is like one of the one of the main acharyas of Gaudiya Vaishnava Sampradaya after Rupa Goswami, Sanatan Goswami. I think this this verse is composed by whom? No, I think this verse is composed by. Actually, this verse is not composed by Srinivas Acharya. This verse is composed by whom? Vairagya Vidya Nija Bhakti Yoga. No. Shikshartham Ekam Purusha Purana. I'm just missing this, the name. Srinivas Acharya or... So there was one devotee who actually wrote a commentary on Srimad Bhagavatam, small. And Srinath Chakravarti. Yeah, this verse is written by Srinath Chakravarti Thakur. Not Srinivas Acharya. Srinath Chakravarti is one of the associates of Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. He writes this, he composed this verse. Vairagya Vidya Nija Bhakti Yoga. And then, of course, this was quoted by Sarvam Bhattacharya also. So, anyway, you can check this, who composed this verse.
This verse was composed by Sarvam
This verse is composed by Sarvam Bhattacharya. I got confused. Yeah, sorry for that. Not Srinath Chakravarti Thakur, not Srinath Acharya, Sarvam Bhattacharya. This verse is composed by Sarvam Bhattacharya. Yeah. Vairagya Vidya Nija Bhakti Yoga. So, even it's opinion Sarvam Bhattacharya. That advancement in devotion can be checked by Vairagya and Vidya. Same Srimad Bhagavatam. So, that's just very important. Jad Bharat is raising the same point here in this verse. Now, Bhagavatam says, if you are advancing in devotion, then you should develop renunciation. And you should develop knowledge. These two things. So renunciation and knowledge. Now the question comes, renunciation in what? And what kind of knowledge? So Jad Bharat is explaining in this verse. You have to have renunciation from what? So the word used in this verse is puram. You have to have renunciation in those things which you are not. Naturally, if I'm not this, if I'm not that, then I should not be attached to it because they don't belong to me. Neither they belong to me and neither I am these things. So why should we be attached to all these things? So Jadvara says, okay, fine, let's make a list. What things you should not be attached to? So he says Puram. Puram means city. City means your nation. Prabhupada translates in word to word. Your nation, your family, your house, your relatives, even your own body. You should not be attached to all these things. So that's very clear. Okay, that becomes clear. But then Jad Bharat goes deeper. Then he says you should not be even attached to these senses. The five working senses, the five knowledge acquiring senses, which actually includes this body. And then you should not be even attached to false ego. False ego means you should not be even attached to your own ideas. Practically, attachment to false ego means you should not be attached to your own ideas, because the function of false ego is to generate ideas. Well, the function of false ego is to generate ideas which are very concrete. That's what false ego does. False ego makes your ideas stable and concrete. That's the function of false ego. Mind also generates ideas, but false ego generates ideas which you believe in, which you are firmly convinced that this is correct, even though if that's not correct. So you should not be attached to your firm ideas. You should not be attached to, because even our firm ideas, which might be based on some evidence, which might be based on some logic, that can be wrong. So if you get more knowledge, more logic, then it can become wrong. Just like science, there are so many facts which are well established, but after some time they become wrong. Why? Because your knowledge increases, and when you see the same phenomena with more knowledge, then your ideas change. That's the history of science. Everybody knows, which is technically called as paradigm shift. Thomas Kuhn, he used the word paradigm shift, paradigm change. So if science can change, the theory of science, which is actually based on rationality and evidence, if that can change, then your own ideas, which are not even scientific, which are just you have thought in your mind and actually formed some logical conclusions, that can be wrong, even if you feel it's 100% correct. Now, why do we feel that my idea is 100% correct? Because of false ego. Because of false ego, we firmly hold on to our ideas. So Jada Bharat is saying, don't do that. And then Jada Bharat is saying, don't be attached to your own mind. So practically that means we should not be attached to our plans, what we make for future. Na shochati na kankshati, or to our past memories. Mind's function is to always think of future or brooding on past. So he said, don't be attached to all these things. Become detached from all these things, and then understand your soul. So this is called renunciation. This is complete renunciation. Not being attached to all these things. Then we are truly renounced. Otherwise, we are not truly renounced. Otherwise, we are still attached. So most of us, we can understand gross things. Most of us, we are not attached to our family, to our relatives. I hope so. Or maybe our society, the society which we are living in. But we don't generally think about detachment from a body, detachment from mind, that's more or less. Detachment from false ego, that's even rare to understand. And really to understand we are soul, that's very difficult. So that is called renunciation. Renunciation, Prabhupada also defines, renunciation means to act on platform of soul. That's also very important to understand. It's not just understanding, okay, so I'm not attached to my ideas, I'm not attached to my plans, I'm not attached to this body. But you have to act like that. So Srila Prabhupada always uses this word, act on the platform of soul. That is called renunciation. Renunciation doesn't mean inaction. You just sit in a cave, close your eyes. You close your eyes and you think, okay, I'm not this body, I'm not senses, I'm not false ego, and you just meditate. That's not renunciation. Renunciation is action. Action on platform of soul. If I'm not all this, then who we are? We are soul. And what's the function of soul? Function of soul is to serve Krishna without being attached to all these items. So that is called as renunciation. That is complete definition of renunciation. Or to work for Krishna and not work for body, senses, and false ego. Not try to fulfill the desires of a body, of a society, of a nation, of a false ego. Not to fulfill our own plans, but to always act on platform of soul. Or in other words, to always act for God, because soul's action is to serve Krishna, to fulfill the plans of Krishna. So that is complete renunciation. That is called as renunciation. That's how we test renunciation. To whom, for whom you are acting for, ultimately. Are you acting for your society, for nation, for your family? What's your intention? So why do you want to do this or that or this or that? For whom? For yourself, for your body, for your health, for your mind, for the peace of your mind, or for the peace of society, or peace of your family, for what you are doing. Or you want to do some action for giving satisfaction to Krishna. So you see the point, Sankhya philosophy leads to devotion, ultimately. And that's why Krishna says in Bhagavad Gita, Sankhya Yog Pritak Bhala Prabhadantina Pandita. Those people who are childish, they say Sankhya and devotion are non-different. But those who are expert, for them, both paths leads to the same goal. Sankhya ultimately leads to devotion, automatically, just like I explained. Sankhya says become detached. Devotion says become attached to Krishna. But ultimately that detachment will lead to attachment to Krishna, ultimately. But if you want to understand how to advance in devotion, we should not check from attachment, we should check always from detachment. That's what Bhagavatam says. Because you can also be sentimentally attached. Just like Bhaktisiddhanta used to say, he is attached to a blue boy and not God. That can happen. So many ladies in India, they are attached to Krishna, Bal Gopal, but they are not attached from their body, from their senses or whatever it is. So it can be a problematic situation, and that's what Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur, he always fought for. He fought his whole life against Sahajism. And this is the philosophy of Sahajya. Okay, if you're attached to Krishna, if you're getting tears in your eyes, if you're getting ecstasy, feeling nice in kirtans, that means you're advancing. It might be, it might not be. It might not be. You can 24 hours keep on chanting. You can 24 hours keep on shedding tears for Krishna. But it might be that you are not advancing an inch in devotion. That's not the opinion of Bhagavatam. That's the opinion of all saints. Christian mystic saints. Even Quran. You see all Islamic saints. All of them, all the theistic organizations, they are very clear on that. That, and if you are advancing in devotion, then there is just one question. How much you are detached to your surroundings, to your body, to your mind, to your false ego. And I just explained what do we mean by detachment to a society, to a body, to a mind, to false ego. So that's the first symptom. The next symptom of advancement in devotion is Janyati Asho Vairagyam Jnanam Chatata Ahitukam. Jnana, knowledge. So this is knowledge. This is knowledge, what Jad Bharat is giving. When you do devotion, automatically you will understand. You will start seeing everything separately. Everything will become separate. When you advance in devotion, you close your eyes, you will be able to see, my body is different, my mind is different, my false ego is different, my body is saying something, my mind is saying something, my false ego is saying something, my soul is saying something. All these voices you will be able to hear clearly, separately. That is called knowledge. Knowledge is not just memorizing shlokas and having some 90% marks or something. That's not knowledge. That is called information. Knowledge is you will be able to see for yourself. So when you close your eyes, some voice will come, some idea will come in your mind. You will be immediately be able to, you will understand this idea is coming from my mind or my false ego, or this idea is coming from society, my friends, from some peer pressure, or this idea is coming from my soul, or maybe Krishna. So that knowledge means discrimination. Discrimination, which Jad Bharat understands here. You'll be able to discriminate on what platform you're working. And that needs little realization. You can understand clearly okay, this idea is coming from my mind, I don't have to entertain this. Or this idea is actually, what do we say, inserted by society or by people into my mind, I don't have to act on this. Or this idea is coming from Kali, Satan. You will understand that slowly and gradually. That is called knowledge. Because if God can insert thoughts in your mind, even Kali can do that. And he will not even understand what's happening. So it's not necessary that ideas which are coming in your head, that are your ideas. It's not like that. Okay, I think like that. So I think means I think. No. Your thought might be coming from your soul, from your mind, from your false ego, from your society, from Satan, from God. Now how do we understand from where that thought is coming? By knowledge you will understand. So this is called renunciation and knowledge. By this we can understand whether we are advancing in devotion or not. So Jad Bharat is exactly speaking the same. Jad Bharat is explaining in details. What do we mean by renunciation? What do we mean by knowledge? If you want to understand renunciation and knowledge, you have to understand this Sankhya philosophy which Jad Bharat is explaining. Otherwise, we will not understand anything. We might be saying, okay, advancement in devotion is judged by renunciation and knowledge. You might have your own definition of renunciation and knowledge. You might think, yeah, I have knowledge because I have done VIHE course and I have got 95% marks. It's good to do VIHE course, but I'm not saying it's bad. But the whole point is, if you think I've done VIHE course and I have 95% marks, or maybe some other course and I've got 95% marks, it's not equivalent to having knowledge. Or you might have your own definition. Yeah, I'm renounced because I don't care for my family, I don't care for society, I don't care for my friends, I don't care for my body. So I'm renounced. That's absurd. That's rubbish. That's not called renunciation. So how do you understand what's renunciation and true knowledge? By understanding this, what Jad Bharat is saying. What are senses? What is mind? What is false ego? What is society? What is our relatives? What is my body? Who am I? And then, so then you have separate compartments. And then you can see, okay, fine. I should not be attached to all these compartments, I should be attached to soul. And I should work on the platform of soul. And what's knowledge? I should be able to understand from where the ideas are coming. And then reject those ideas which are coming from body, mind, false ego, senses, society. And accept those ideas which are coming from your soul. That's called renunciation and knowledge. This is how Jad Bharat is explaining in this verse. And so you see the point. Devotees often think, what's the use of this knowledge? And Jad Bharat is saying 11 senses, mind, false ego, who cares for that? Let's chant and be happy. Generally devotees think like that, am I right? Let's do some kirtan and that's fine. But that's not fine. You can do devotion, but you will not understand whether you're advancing or not. And that's very important to understand. I mean, to say you're shooting arrows in darkness. And if you don't understand you're advancing or not, then eventually you'll fall down. Because if you don't know what's happening, where you're going, then you're lost. And a lost person, if you're lost in a jungle, eventually you'll be killed by some wild animal. You should exactly know the way, especially in a forest. So this is a forest of material world and you should know the way out. Okay, this is the way and this is the goal. And that's why there is so much discussion of philosophy. And that's why Srimad Bhagavatam actually spends a lot of time on these kind of discussions. Body, 11 senses, mind. You see whole chapters after chapters of Kapil Muni, Sankhya philosophy. So what's that canto? Third canto? Entire third canto is full of these discussions. What is body? What is senses? What is mind? What are sense objects? What is sense perception? What are three modes of material nature? How mind is produced a mode of goodness? How senses are produced a mode of passion? How sense objects are produced a mode of ignorance? How they interact under influence of time? Everything is explained. So is third canto of Bhagavatam not important? Or if it's not important, then why did Prabhupada translate? Prabhupada could have just translated 10th canto. Krishna book, that's all. Finish it off. Or even 11th canto, the same subjects are coming back again. In fact, all entire Bhagavatam is full of this knowledge, Sankhya philosophy, theistic Sankhya, which we call it, which ultimately helps to enter, which ultimately helps us to enter devotion. Then you come to 10th canto. Then 10th canto subject is Krishna. Then you connect to Krishna. Because if you don't understand whether Krishna is speaking or my mind is speaking or society is speaking or my senses are speaking or my false ego is speaking, then how do you serve Krishna? That's the most important point. We are after all servants of Krishna. We are not sense enjoyers of Krishna. So then the whole point is, then how do you serve Him? So to serve Him, we need to understand all these things. And that is called as Uttamadhikari. That's why Bhagavatam says, Janyati Asho Vairagyam Jnanam Satat Ahitukam. If you do devotion, Vairagya and knowledge will appear in your life. But renunciation, knowledge will only appear if you want them to appear. If you understand what is renunciation and knowledge, then they will appear in life. They will enter your life. If you don't understand anything and if you just keep on going like that, then nothing will happen. And even if something happens, you will not notice it and it will just come and go. You will not be able to keep it with yourself. That's the whole point there. Because our definitions are wrong. Our definition of knowledge is different, our definition of renunciation is different. If your definitions are different, then you perceive the entire thing differently. And then you will not be able to advance properly. So, this is a verse, this verse is not redundant, that's my whole point. I have just explained in this lecture how this verse is connected to devotion. It's not a redundant knowledge Jad Bharat is trying to give to Rahugan. We don't have to follow the footsteps of Jad Bharat. We have to follow the footsteps of gopis. So Jad Bharat, who is Jad Bharat? Who cares for him? No, I mean, we can just think like that. He's a yogi, he's a renunciate. We are devotees of Raj and gopis. This is how Sahijyas think. This is how they talk. But pure devotees, they don't talk like this. Jad Bharat is a pure devotee and he knows what he's doing. And he's speaking what is relevant to all of us. To elevate to the platform of Gopi Bhav. Our target is gopis, of course. To serve Krishna under the gopis. But we'll not be able to do it if we can't even recognize that, if we can't even become detached from our body, mind, false ego, and if we don't have true knowledge, true discrimination, then we are bound to get entangled in this material world and fall down. So we must keep in mind these explanations of Jad Bharat. These are very practical explanations. It's not just theory. 11 senses, mind, false ego, okay, this is some theory. No. It is practical. I have explained to you what is the practical use of all these things. You have to know all these things separately so that you will be able to discriminate whom to listen. Soul or mind or false ego, what to do? And whom to become attached and whom not to become detached. And whom not to become attached. These things should be clear enough. Anyway, Hare Krishna, so I'll just stop here. Any questions or anything? I'll just finish.